The first thing is sad news that our past president, Eiji Toyoda, has died very recently at the age of 100 years and 3 days, I think. So he was not in a very good health the last years, but he managed to keep abreast of everything that happened at Toyota until the last minute. And he was really the architect of the expansion of Toyota outside Japan, but also the Toyota way and the Toyota production system. Also, it's interesting to read his book, not for many details about the Toyota way, but about the history of Toyota and how the concept came to life in the very difficult situation in Japan after the war. So I will give a brief introduction to Toyota Motor Europe, which I will try to do as quickly as possible, and then focus on some of the concepts, and then talk about IT at Toyota and why it's different from other ITs. Now, I know that most of you are not IT people. Don't worry. Normally, it's IT people who come to me after presentation and say, "But you didn't talk about IT." So this will be normally the case today as well, or not much at least. So Toyota Motor Europe, how does it fit within the global Toyota family? So globally, Toyota was established a bit more than 75 years ago now as a car manufacturing. But of course, Toyota started in the automatic looms with Sakichi Toyoda. And you will see some of the concepts date back to that time rather than to the automotive time. Now, the results now are quite good. We sell close to 10 million cars. I just saw the results half year. They were actually published today in Japan. So we reached 1 trillion yen in the first half of this year of profit. So there must be something right somewhere in the way it's done. The market share is very different in different parts of the world, which gives very interesting and different challenges. Yeah? So in Japan, we are close to 50% market share, which means that, for example, today, if we take the traffic information from the Toyota cars in Japan, that Toyota can get hold of, we have basically an ideal telematic system that gives you everything that happens in Japan for traffic. In Europe, we are closer to 5%, which is a very different type of challenge. That means we are in a very difficult market, very competitive market, and actually it's better to apply lean, linked to what we just heard from Dan Jones. We are also the company that started with hybrid, and our hybrid sales are more than 5 million by now. Actually, the hybrid share is huge, like 75% in Europe, and is increasing this year compared to last year, because we moved hybrid to lower size of cars, actually. And we have more than 300,000 employees worldwide. Now you can see here the regional headquarters for Toyota Motor Europe. The headquarters is in Brussels. And we have here Toyota Motor Europe with more modest figures, let's say, up to now. But still, we have around 10% of the total Toyota sales. Now, still, it gives work to close to 100,000 people in Europe, and there were investments of around 8 billion euros already made by Toyota in Europe. So we have some facilities, like the head office I mentioned, but very importantly, we have an R&D center in Europe, which is also located in Brussels. We have Toyota Motorsport, which worked in Formula One and now in World Endurance Championship, like Le Mans, and there's a race in Shanghai next Sunday, a 6 hours race that we hope to win, but Audi is a big competitor for us in that context. And we have a European Design and Development Center in Nice or Sofia Antipolis in the south of France. Now we have 9 manufacturing sites in Europe that you can see here. There are 2 in the UK, one in Deeside in Wales making engines, and we have TM UK in Burnaston, close to Derby, making Auris Hybrid and Avensis. And you can see the other ones. We also now moving more and more to European operations, the plant in Russia, which is in St. Petersburg. That will move from a CKD plant to a parts by parts ordering plant. So we have a lot of IT activity there now. These are the vehicles. So around two-thirds of the vehicles sold in Europe are made in Europe. So you see the list here. Actually, the last one on the list, Toyota ProAce, is made by PSA and sold by Toyota after rebadging. But we also built the small cars of PSA by Toyota in the Toyota factory in Czech Republic. So the C1 and 107 cars of PSA are built by Toyota, actually. So we have many logistics companies for service parts and for vehicle supply chain. And we have 30 national marketing and sales companies that we call NMSCs that cover 56 countries, because our Europe goes to countries like Kazakhstan or Kyrgyzstan, where I will be next week, actually. So it's a big geography with a lot of diversity. Retailers are around 3,000 in total with Toyota and Lexus retailers. Now, moving to the core of the presentation. So I will first give you a few slides. It is not at all exhaustive, but there are 7 slides explaining concept of the Toyota production system and how, if you think deeply about them, how you can actually apply them very well to IT. But I will show you 7 of them. Actually, I have around 200 of them where we could make the same similar type of slides. So I'm actually making a dictionary. But what is important is not to have a dictionary, is to make the dictionary. Because when you make the dictionary, you think about all of those concepts, and it can give you a lot of ideas, actually. And anyway, the main takeaway point is most of the concepts of the Toyota production system can be used successfully in IS, and as we will see also in many other sectors. Even they don't come from automotive, so they were already yokotened or shared from a different industry to the automotive industry. So as a first example, Jidoka, which is one of the 2 pillars of the Toyota production system with just in time. I wrote just in time in Japanese, but it reads Jasutu in Taimu, so don't worry, it's the same in English. But Jidoka means automation. We say it was before it was said autonomation or automation with a human touch. The point is that originally in the automatic loom, Sakichi Toyoda saw that it was the threads were breaking regularly and so on. And as a consequence, when a problem happened, the problem became worse if you didn't stop immediately and solve the problem. Now, this is done a lot in the factories, and you will see on the undone concept later. But if you apply to IS, this is the same. We have seen in IS so many cases where something is going wrong, but nobody is recognizing that it's going wrong, and then the problem is spreading everywhere. Of course, a virus is also a very good example of that, but that's a bit a different reason. But even if you don't intend to do harm, this can happen quite a lot. So there, the right thing to do is to have a program that will recognize a problem, stop, enable you to solve the problem, or solve it automatically if it's possible, and then continue. Another concept is Gentani, which is a basic unit of work that you measure. For example, if you know the cost of an email per user per month, you can look at better ways to manage your emails. Many companies actually don't know how much it costs. If you don't know how much it costs, it's very difficult to see which option would be better. Yeah? So you always need to have these basic KPIs that you can use. Of course, it's done very extensively in the factories. But every IT department can use the Gentani, like number of function points delivered per number of mandates. This type of information, if you have it, you have a basis, you have a standard that you can then further improve. So this is something that we are using quite a lot in IT as well. Something obvious probably already for all of you is the visualization. And you just saw some great example of very simple visualization that can be understood by anybody. So this is a key in everything we do. You see that a lot in the plants, of course, but in IT, my colleagues always tell me the problem with IT is we never know what is the progress, where you are, and so on. So to be able also for ourselves, if we have to manage an IT department, to know what is the real progress is extremely important. Yeah, there are so many cases of IT systems that we thought were 95% complete. They were actually 50% complete or maybe 10% complete. So we have a lot of emphasis in the visualization of the progress. So typically, and this is never a very sophisticated methodology, but in each phase of an IT project, you have a number of items that you need to deliver, and you have a time to deliver those items. Then you can make a planning saying, I have 100 items to deliver. My plan is to deliver 5 today, 1 tomorrow, 10 the day after. And then you just measure against this plan and you visualize the situation. You can see very quickly if there's a gap, if you're ahead of schedule, if you're behind schedule. If you're behind schedule, you have the conversation on what are the reasons, how to remove those obstacles, and how to countermeasure. It's so simple, but it's so difficult to do, and so few people actually do it. It's really always amazing. And I must say, maybe from what I show today, you will think we do it ideally. It's not true at all. We are struggling internally also to continuously coach people to do this well. The next example I took is Pokayoke, which is an error protection device or foolproof device that, of course, in the plants, many errors can happen. It's the same in IT. So those devices make sure that whenever an error happens, actually it's immediately visible or even it's made impossible for the operator to make this error. So there are all kinds of different devices that can achieve this. If I take the analogy to IT again, the computer is, well, in Italian, an idiot that does things very quickly. So it's the ideal candidate to be to apply Pokayoke, actually. So again, as I said before, you can, if you have an issue that occurs, it can spread everywhere, and later you have all your data corrupted. It's much more difficult to countermeasure. But you have simple things like everybody knows a check digit for a bank account, which enables you to see directly that there's a mistake in the bank account number that you just typed. And the system will tell you, no, it's not correct, please correct it. Another concept that we hear a lot is undone. Now, it's interesting to look at the Japanese character because people think there's an undone board, or there's an undone cord, so people say pull the undone. What it actually means is a lamp. It's an ancient paper lamp in Japan. And then it was used as the meaning to visualize the progress of the production in the factories on the so-called undone board. But then also it was used in the meaning of undone cord, where each worker at our factories was allowed to stop the line if there was a problem, and then people would focus on solving the problem structurally. But it started even before with the automatic loom of Sakichi Toyoda. Now, in IT, you have many applications of this as well. And I must say, we are not always very good at doing that. Like normally, a programmer could see that there is a huge problem around him on his project. He should be able to pull the cord and say, stop, what I'm doing here doesn't make sense. I need management attention. I stop every work until this is solved. And the management should actually be able to convene very quickly to support the programmer to solve his issue. Yeah? So this is something that I believe we can also improve a lot on doing this kind of things. Because it creates always a lot of focus on a problem when you really stop the work. Now we do this at major gateways in IT systems also. If the systems integration testing is not completed and you already start the user acceptance test, then quickly the users will will stop having trust in the system, and you will have a lot of blaming going on and so on. While if you deliver your software that works well, then it's much better to move to the next phase and do it well. Heijunka, which is the leveling, the origin of this was, Toyota had to adapt the production to scarce resources. They could not fluctuate easily the manpower and so on. So they had to lever their activity based on the parts that they got and so on. Now it is very, very difficult to apply and sometimes very counterintuitive, because you may feel that, yeah, if I can produce much more today, it's good, and okay, maybe later it will be less and so on. But if you force yourself to produce the same quantity every day, you can get much better results for quality. Also in IT, you can imagine if you have a team of four people that produce excellent quality, just to say, okay, I will now take 10 people more, but they don't know at all the job, so they will produce poor quality. This will create many problems. And then later I come back to four people. It's better if you can organize the job to make sure that this team of four people is continuously delivering programs with very good quality. But that means, of course, that you need to regulate the inputs that will arrive to these teams. And you can see here also the case I just said. You can have a situation that you have urgent flows that need to be handled quickly, but you have a basic flow that needs to be continuously handled with very good quality as well. If you separate the flows, you can have incredible improvement in IT. So here I have the three words that you can hear very often in TPS, Muri, Mura, and Muda, in this order, that you need to remove. So it's interesting that the mu in the tree is not always the same mu. So the first and the third one, mu means not. And the second one is mura, is just one Chinese character. But the first one means no reason, unreasonable. So this is actually overburden. Overburden can be on the machines. It can be on the people. This is, in general, a bad thing to have. So you need to first remove that. And then you have the muda, which is the mura, sorry, which is the unevenness, which is countermeasured by the heijunka that I just explained. And then you have the muda, which is the waste, which you can read a lot of things about the seven kinds of waste and so on. So obviously, also in an IT department, there are all kinds of waste. Waste occurs between the people who request the systems and the IT departments, but also between the IT departments within IT, there can be a lot of waste that we can remove, actually. So this is just an example of what you can do with those concepts to apply them basically to a different context. Now I will try to explain to you what is different about IT at Toyota. And one of the main differences is not really an IT as a service provider that will take orders and develop systems. In many cases, our first response is, well, you don't need a system, or you don't need a system yet. Yeah? So later, maybe when it's very clear what needs to be done and what are the benefits to automate, we will do. So I will show you a number of things. I don't claim that we do all of them perfectly ourselves, and I don't claim that it is easy. It is extremely difficult to achieve those things. But just to give you some ideas of what we are trying to do and what we believe can make us successful. So I will explain now in five parts. So the first one will be about people and culture, how we manage the culture and the expectations of our IS teams across Europe. Then I will talk about putting customer first and what it really means for us. Then the purpose, how to ensure we know where we are going, which we ask constantly. The processes, which were mentioned by Dan also. Should we simply automate every manual process? Of course, the answer will be no. And the progress, so how do we make sure that we are making a change for good, a sustainable change? So the first part is on people and culture. So how do our people and culture contribute to our IS activities? So there we try to answer the questions like those. So how implementing a Toyota Way culture is different from just using lean tools and performing one-off activities. How we engage our customers and our suppliers in our process. How we use every opportunity to share the learning within the company, and how we aim to be open to others' new ideas, tools, and techniques as long as they are addressing relevant problems. So first, about the Toyota Way culture, and we put things a bit differently from what we normally do at the company, but to show you some very important components of that. We aim for a virtuous circle. Develop people, of course, is essential. A manager who doesn't coach their staff for us is not a manager, so that is an essential key part of the manager role. Using the entire management chain to support this continuous development. So development of people is a key activity that we have. Now on the bottom left, customer focus is key, of course, also. So everyone's role is to fully play their part to support our company's goals. And everything we do must add value. Not value to some intermediate processes, but in the end, value to the customer. That the staff should understand clearly. Everybody of the staff should understand how what they do will contribute to adding value. And nobody should then lack interest in the business aims and objectives, because that's where we can explain the value that is added. Now, there is challenge on the top right. We challenge the staff to make improvements in their own areas by themselves. And problem solving always starts with a thorough knowledge of the current situation. And indeed, problem solving is a practice that must be done many, many times to improve, and the process of doing problem solving must improve also along the way, and will improve along the way if it's practiced. The daily cycle, we regard this learning challenging process as part of our daily work. Yeah? So it's not that you do one training in problem solving. Every new employee at Toyota has a training to learn doing what we call TBP, the 8 steps process to do problem solving. The first one you do will take you 6 months because you will get a lot of coaching. You will do 25 versions of your A3. Many of them will be destroyed and you will have to redo completely. So after that, it's easy to give up, of course. But the second one will already be better. And if you have done that for 30 years, you can do really incredible deep thinking on problem solving, and you have the capability to solve all kinds of problems that may arise. So if you don't practice, you never get to that level. So we look for every opportunity to improve ourselves as individual, as a team, and as part of the company, and then supporting the community as well. So if we think about suppliers, what does it mean? And that is something that I take a lot of time to talk to suppliers in Europe, and I guess it's the same for my colleagues in North America, because in many cases, suppliers believe that they have to make deals with us, so they try to get the best value for them. But then the learning and so on, it does not happen very easily, because a supplier believes if he makes a mistake, he should hide the mistake, otherwise we will ask compensation and things like that. So the way that you negotiate with supplier itself has to be different. And the way that we talk about their mistakes and how they should improve, at the same time, we should talk also about our mistakes and what we can do to improve. So to create this culture together with Western suppliers is quite difficult to achieve. But it is possible. It just takes a longer term relationship. Yeah? So we cannot have too many changes there. This is why we tend not to change suppliers many times. And try to keep the same. Even if they are not very good at the start, if they have the attitude to improve, they will become good after a while. So that's what we try to achieve. If we don't see the willingness to recognize mistakes, share mistakes, improve, then the suppliers themselves may change at some point. So the coaching, of course, accepting the coaching And ideally, of course, then the suppliers can improve by themselves and give a great contribution to Toyota, and in return, also get more business from Toyota. Cross-company sharing I mentioned before, so I try to always go to events organized by other parts of the companies. For example, we have a European Production Kaizen meeting, or EPKM, which are held in our various plants every 3 months. So this is a one-day event where people from all the plants convene, and we do Gemba work. So most of the day is shop floor observation. And I'm always amazed how much I can take back to my own IT operations when I watch what is happening at the plants. And so I just wish that I could send more of my own team to attend those events. And in order to achieve some of this experience within IT, I moved basically these best practices of EPKM into IT, and we are creating now an event that we call EIKM, European IT Kaizen Meeting, where people from IT in various locations come together, and we explain also to our top management the activities we have, the problems we encountered, and our improvement and the result of our improvement to make it visible. Also, it enables us to make visible people who are doing the daily job in IT, who normally are invisible to top management, but with these events, they are in the middle. We are just behind, basically, and they make great presentations to top management. That is quite motivating for them, but of course helps IT to be recognized as bringing value to the organization. And then, of course, we receive also perspective from the top management from different perspectives that we can reflect upon. So we do one such event every year. So this month there will be the second one. Retain an open mind. It is essential. In IT, it is not that we could say, okay, IT is not the most important thing for Toyota, so we will just look inside Toyota, apply the Toyota practices, and ignore the world outside Toyota. This is, in IT, certainly totally impossible. So what we do is, instead of taking consultants who will tell us what is the hype of the day, we basically look at the trends, but we try to sort out what is really relevant for Toyota at this point in time. So we don't just try to copy things that are considered best practices for others, but we listen and we take what we think will really bring value to our customers, basically. So we only use technology and tools when we understand and agree with the process. There was, at the very start of Toyota, this advice from our founder, yeah, open the window, it's a big world out there. It's very simple advice. So the next one is about putting customer first. We are constantly working on this slide because, and it's surely not the last version, but of course, when you want to do that, the first question is, who is the customer? And if we make cars, of course, we have many customers who are driving our cars. We may even have people inside the cars who are not driving, who are our customers also. We can have fleet customers and so on. And then within the company, as IT, if I just do what the various business units are telling me that they need, I could see them as customers, but actually I have to look behind that, because if I just do that, yeah, I will spend a lot of money for IT and I won't bring enough value. So in some cases, I sort out what is requested by all the business units, and I go directly to top management and we choose what are really priorities for the company. Now, the top management has arrived there because they have a good view of the customers, and they represent the customers also towards us. However, I don't listen only to top management either. Yeah? What we need to do for real customers behind them is also very important to understand. And so we can challenge also the top management judgment. But you see on the top right, top management has to balance customer value, company sustainability, and contribution to society. So surely their opinion on the high-level hoshin of what we want to do is very important. We have two parts here. So the customer first is in the middle. On the left part, we have delivering value to the end customer, which we always need to carefully measure. We constantly need to have in mind where is the value, what is the value that we deliver. We need frequent business talks to define how what we do is fitting customer needs. And we need to consider customer first foundations in doing the above. We see also through new technologies, we have ways to get much more customer insights than what was the case before. Through telematics, we can get insight about the behavior of customers directly in using our cars, or through social media, we can get millions of informations about what customers think. So this is an input that is very relevant in this context. So on the right, we have to deliver business process improvement. So there we discuss with management, top management within IT and with the top management of the company. And of course, we discuss with all the business units. But very important, number three, avoiding the trap of being just a service provider. Yeah? We never want to be a service provider. It doesn't mean we shouldn't provide a good service, of course. But it's not we just do what you ask us to do without thinking. And that puts us then in a powerful position by engaging across the business units and business processes to facilitate a good change. And the challenge for me is always to be recognized in this position by the top management of the company. So we have many, many interactions. Because as Dan explained last year, there are different perspectives of the CEO, the CIO, and so on. So if you have to reconcile those various positions, you need a number of conversations to align. So I think I said most of that. So customer first foundations, we need to go to the gamba. We need to observe the real operations. Yeah, how many times did we see that systems are developed by people who actually don't know how it actually works, who never went to see the people performing their job like they do today? So this is a mistake that we should really eradicate. Yeah? Ideally, even an IT person who will work on a system should perform the job of the users before developing the system. So we have a graduate program. In most cases, we hire graduates. We don't hire experienced people. And the graduates in their program, in their inception program, they will go to line training for 6 weeks, but they will also have a placement in another department. So typically, if we hire somebody to work on a system in IT, they will first work in the department that they will need to develop the system for. And that will create first a good relationship with the people in those departments. They will communicate much better, and they will understand the job that they need to cover. And maybe they will recommend to simplify the processes first before developing a system. So the next part is about purpose. So how to ensure we know where we are going in everything we do. So this is not a Japanese guy, but he is very important for the Japanese industry. So Deming has said quality comes not from the inspection, but from the improvement of the production process. So it is important to understand the essence of what we are trying to achieve. We use the Hoshin-Kanri, so the direction management, the compass, and the PDCA processes to achieve this. We engage the very highest level of management to do this effectively. And we have special attention to closing the loop, because many PDCAs start with P and D and then they stop. Sometimes it's just D, but surely the C and the A is a key part. If you don't do that, of course, you don't do PDCA. It seems obvious, but it's also very hard to achieve. So if you look here, you have the PDCA cycle of IT. So on the bottom left, we have the plan where we gather information from many sources to do midterm plans, so several years or yearly plans. And then they move into a do phase, which has its own PDCA cycle, because there we execute the project. We have several phases. Sometimes we are using agile methodologies with smaller cycles. So this is PDCA within the do phase. And then at the end of the project, we have have the check that we have achieved the quality, the timing, and the cost, and that we have delivered the required business benefits. And then based on those results, we act. So either we didn't deliver enough benefit, we have to act to start a new project, or we delivered very good benefits, then we have to share this best practice with others. So I have, you don't need to read the slide, but this is just to show some examples of what we have there. So at the start of the project, we prepare what is called a ringi. This is a standard Japanese word that means basically to put on a piece of paper the agreement created by Nemawashi with many parties. So once this agreement is clear, you put it on paper, you show the current situation, you show the target situation, you show what you want to improve, you explain why you chose that solution, what will be the benefit, what will be the planning of the project. Then, of course, when the project is completed, you get this document back, and normally you could even prepare that even at the start of the project, because you should know at the start how you are going to measure the benefits that you will deliver, for example. So at the end, we have an example here for the same project where we close officially the project, typically 3 to 6 months after the go live of the project. And then we measure how we prepared the project, the cost, quality, and timing KPIs, whether we had post-go-live issues, and whether we achieved the promised benefits. This is here maybe not the best example, because it was a very good project which has a very high score on all categories. It is not always the case. And of course, we learn even more from the projects that had problems. Yeah? So this, of course, happens also at Toyota. The important thing is the learning. So here is a picture of Steve Bell, who has written a few books on Lean IT, who came to visit us recently. So we are there in our IT Obeya. So you can see there the various projects we have in various areas. On the other side that you don't see here, we have our vision and strategy and midterm plans. And we can see at a glance, even though it's not very clear on this picture, what is the status of each project. And if I see a cross somewhere in an area, I can zoom down on this cross and ask questions and try to support applying countermeasures. Of course, again, this has absolutely no meaning to do if you don't have a team that will visualize the real issues. If everybody says everything is circle, no problem, then we don't need an Obeya either. But when we can visualize that and we can improve so that in the end we don't have many problems to focus on, as a management we can really focus on them and support the team to deliver the projects. So then on processes, I will give a bit of history, also conscious of the time. So in the 40s, after the war, Toyota was faced with a problem, which is the changeover time for sheet metal press machines were long. And was that a problem for them? Because they needed to produce many different types of cars in small quantities. And the American automotive industry, by contrast, was actually making cars in big batches. So it was not such a big problem that to exchange the dies, they needed 12 to 24 hours. However, at Toyota, to have large batch sizes meant inventory, which meant waste, which meant cost. So this hampered the smooth implementation of many of the Toyota production system principles. And the high land cost in Japan meant that vehicle inventory had a huge financial impact, which was, of course, much less so in North America. So a significant process change was required, which became known as SMET, which means single digit minute exchange of die. And this approach reduced this time from 12 to 24 hours down to 9 minutes. After that, even less than that. But while retaining the high flexibility that was needed. So this is about breakthrough thinking. Here, Shingo-san, who participated to that, said it's only the last turn of a bolt that tightens it, The rest is just movement. So if you think about it, yeah, also privately, you're probably tightening bolts regularly, and you are turning for 1 minute, and then you tighten. Yeah. So if you think about it, there are ways to go directly to the place where you can tighten your bolt. So this type of basic ideas has actually supported a lot to improve this. And if you look at those four steps, well, if we say level zero is before improvement, then we have level one, which is human improvement and quick wins. So there we define roles, measures, and accountabilities. Well, very similar to the house that we saw before from Dan. Coach the teams and look for immediate process improvements and create standardized work. Then at the level two, process improvements, retrieve the parts before the changeover, mark the standard settings on the equipment, eliminate waiting and unnecessary motion. And then the step three says install quick release mechanisms and eliminate adjustments, modularize equipment, and then at the very end, implement automation, finally. So if I make the analogy with IT, and I will show you, it is exactly the same. Yes? So IT comes at the very end. But we have to check on behalf of the company that the other steps have been actually performed. So if we look at this simplification before automation, so we address the simplification and the manual applications of a process before the system development, which gives us more agility and ability to Kaizen our processes or improve. This is different from many other companies, and our business units react to this differently. That means that, of course, if I work for a marketing department who wants a website, it's not very easy to tell them, okay, please just trial this website manually for a few years, and then we'll automate it eventually. However, there are similar ways to do things like that. We can do also trials of the websites. We can do trials of the user interface and so on. So it's not because we work differently with different business units that we cannot have the same thinking behind. But of course, in areas like manufacturing and logistics, we have doing that much longer time, and we are working with business units who understand deeper the Toyota production system, and it's natural for them to do this trial. In other business units, and that's a very interesting part of my job because I'm facing 24 different business units with very different backgrounds and mindsets, so to explain those things and the benefit of those things to all of those business units. If you can do that, you really enjoy huge benefits. And of course, the cost of IT is only a fraction of what it is in other companies as a result. So if I take the analogy of SMED to business process improvement, you see level zero and one as exactly the same. So what is in red characters on this slide is what has changed. So on step two, we start to see some different things like eliminate waiting and unnecessary transfer of information, establish measurement standards to ensure high quality, establish and ensure necessary conditions for success, what is called Ryohin Joken in Japanese, and level three, use tools where they support a quality process, only when they are needed, eliminate one by one variation and judgment-based input, and then finally implement an IT system. So, get the process right. Our focus on right process, right systems means we may allow a variety of approaches to coexist and then reflect on their efficiency. Survival of the fittest will determine the winner. I made a small post on one of the blogs that in our company, some people were surprised that we still use waterfall methodology because agile methodology has also its roots in the Toyota production system. So why don't we use only agile methodology? It's not the best approach for everything we do. There are cases where waterfall works better. There are cases where we do a mix of waterfall and agile, or we do simultaneous engineering of phases, and there are cases where we do fully agile. Actually, each of those things, we try to apply the one that is the best adapted to the condition where we are and to gradually improve on each of those approaches. To make the best process and system, we will also adapt our organization to bring people who know the Gemba to develop the systems rather than those who ignore it, as I said before. So the application of methodology, I anticipate it on this one. So rather than imposing a method, make sure that we have a minimal set of gateways. This is very important because even you can believe you are doing agile and it's great, you are working with your users, they are very satisfied about the software you deliver in small pieces which add value every time. And then after a number of months, you look at the budget and you say, oh, yeah, I actually spent 200,000 euros here, but I didn't have the money. So we really need to do those projects in a framework that is linked to the company objectives as well. Otherwise, you can always improve and get an ideal thing just for one user who is not a final customer, by the way. And he may be very satisfied, but that is not the end goal. So we need to have gateways for projects. For example, the approval to start doing that project or to do an improvement activity in a particular area, we have to have thinking at that time and we have to compare that activity with other potential activity that could bring more value to the customers. So the methodology must embody the principles of built-in quality with ownership that we call Jikotei Kanketsu, but you can say built-in quality. That means the quality in everything we do, and each employee should be able to judge the quality of what he is producing towards the next step in the chain. Finally, on progress, so how to make sure that we are making a change for good. So we have here an impressive statement from Eiji Toyoda that was already long ago, but he said our workers provide 1.5 million suggestions a year and 95% of them are put to practical use. So this means really listen to what your workers, your employee have as ideas on how to improve their job and make sure that the management supports them to implement their idea rather than being there to say, no, we have no time for this or we think this is not relevant, because they know better than us what is relevant for them. Yeah? So this is extremely important. You see here there's a tangible concern for improvement in the air. So this is the kind of culture that is not so easy to create, but when you create it, you can imagine the power that it can create. So how do we pursue improvement? We relentlessly pursue improvement of each process. Every member is involved in this activity, and we want to innovate and set the standard higher than we can achieve right now, after carefully understanding the priorities and risks. Now on the slide, you can see the seven types of muda, actually, that we have to remove and then gradually improve. About problem solving, we have two types of problem solvings. The first one is that you have a standard, but the current situation is different from your standard, so you have a gap and you need to solve the problem. So this is an exception or gap type of problem. You know what is the correct functioning and you have a dysfunctioning. Now, you have a much more ambitious type of problem, which is that you have a current standard, but you want to raise the bar and go to a future possible level of performance. And then this is what we call a setting or a stretch type of problem. So if you are more advanced in problem solving, you have done many of the type that you see at the bottom part of the slide, then you can start doing the second type of problem. And this, of course, enables the company as a whole to progress to a new dimension. So on the left part, this is about Toyota business practices. So you have the 8 steps of problem solving at Toyota that you could recognize very well in an example that was shown before. So we always clarify the problem first, then break down the problem, set target. Very interesting that we set targets before we have done the root cause analysis. So that means we set an ambition, which may be impossible to achieve, but it has to be a high ambition at that time. And then we do root cause analysis. When we find the root cause of the problem, we develop countermeasure. We see the countermeasures through, so we monitor the do phase, and then we monitor the results and the processes, and we standardize successful processes and start the next iteration. Now you can see on the left that these eight steps, actually the five first steps are the plan of the PDCA, and then we have Do, Check, Act. We focus a lot on this planning part. Yeah? But we also make sure that it goes to the end and that it doesn't stop after the plan, because obviously the do is important, but even more the check and the act. That means that if you have been successful in solving a particular problem, then you may use the same learning to solve many other problems elsewhere, or to share your positive experience. If you don't do that, you have just solved one problem. If you do that, you can solve hundreds and thousands of problems. Now, on the right side of this slide, the motivational guidelines, or what we are bearing in mind when doing these things, is customer first. Well, this time I put it first. Then always confirm the purpose of your work. Take ownership and responsibility. Visualization, Miruka, that I explained at the beginning. Judgment based on fact, not on politics. And I agree that there's a lot of things we can simplify in a head office. I'm in a head office myself. We have reduced the headcount by a number of 100 people in this head office gradually, but the value is not created at the head office. I say in the case of IT, it's a bit different because we have an IT that is not based at the head office anymore. So we have taken the people in the various places of the organization. So we have people in factories, we have people in the sales organizations in the countries, and together we have brought them as one we call pan-European IT organization. So I'm sure that I have in my team people who really are close to the operations where we need to deploy the system. So they are not a head office as such. Well, however, they can be improved a lot also. So judgment based on fact, think and act persistently, speedy action in a timely manner, follow each process with sincerity and commitment, thorough communication, and involve all stakeholders. All of these things are essential and we shouldn't forget any of them. So the progress through the innovation. How do we promote innovation? Because sometimes people may tell us, okay, but what you do is you always try not to do IT, so how are you actually innovating with IT? Well, in some cases, there are IT ideas that can support us a lot as a company. So we encourage everybody in IT to come up with innovation ideas. Maybe some of them, and many of our employees, will have better ideas than we do. And we encourage them to come up with their ideas. And we have once per year an IS Innovation Fair where good ideas have been selected and are actually presented to our user community. So not only within IT, but all the management and the employees of the company can see the innovation that we show, and it can give them idea on how they could use IT to improve their processes. Of course, it doesn't mean we will automatically do that, but they can find bright ideas to improve their processes. Also, we are using knowledge management tools. So we have thought a lot recently about how to share the knowledge, because of course, if you have one team in one location, and the people never leave the company, like we had at some point in Toyota in Japan, it is much easier to share knowledge than if you have a diverse geographies with people with different languages and cultures who need to share information. And there, of course, we have IT tools that can support a lot. So I probably today, after giving this speech, I will post on a chatter group that I've done this with the presentation so that all the members of our IT in Europe can also see it and react to it. And this type of enabler is key to our activity. But more than that, we want to share knowledge, not just file shares or things like that. So we are working on how to store the information in ways that it can be retrieved very easily, and that if people leave the company, their knowledge is not lost, and so on. So this is a big focus for us in Europe, but what we have done in Europe is also being shared now globally. And prioritize the innovation to make sure they are relevant to the business, of course. So we don't allocate money to innovation with a percentage rule, like I spend 10%, 20% of my budget to innovation. But when we have a good innovation, there we will direct budget to that one to make it work for the company. So let's not forget about process. So bringing the progress team back to process, we want to innovate our processes. So probably most of you know the Ono circle, Taichi Ono, the inventor of TPS, I may say. He drew a circle and he told the new employees, please stand in the circle and watch the operations for one complete day or more until you understand more or less what is happening around you. And then after that observation, you can move to some action to improve things. Yeah? So this is very important, a very important principle. So we want to do what we think is right, not being afraid to propose, test, and introduce a new way of doing things. So this brings me to the end of the presentation. So in summary, after introducing Toyota Europe, I hope I have helped you understand some of the background and essence of some Toyota terms and principles. Well, I recognize in 45 minutes, it's a bit short to explain many years of practice, but mainly I hope I have explained how Toyota Motor Europe IS is relentlessly pursuing improvement by using and improving our own understanding of Toyota way. Thank you.